Hello, everyone. I'm Joel Baird, the General Manager of Missoula Community Access TV.
And I'm Kim Anderson. I'm on the board of MCAT, and I'm the Director of Programs and Grants at Humanities Montana.
We want to welcome you to our Missoula Live. It is February 22nd.
But we're not live.
Yeah, but it's typically not live 13 out of 14 times.
That's true.
So
that's right.
We're going to be more relaxed, though. They'll notice that we're not live.
But
that's the name,
the
name of the show,
right?
Is Missoula Live.
Right.
Ironically enough. It is Tuesday. It's very rainy.
Yeah.
We were gone for President's Day. So we're back. And I have just a little news of MCAT to share with folk, and that is we've augmented our Saturday animation drop-in with virtual realities.
This is amazing.
Right? There's kind of a binocular view into a computer program that allows you to see in all directions. You can look at the ground or the sky or the left and the right. And what I really like is the ocean. So it has an ocean thing called blue, without the E, but it has whale encounter. So if you
I should have tried that one.
Yeah, and it has, did you do coral reef?
No, what I did was the huge alien ants on a subway train.
Oh, my goodness, I had no idea.
It was kind of scary.
Oh. Well, Scott is showing the folks at home.
Oh, yeah, there it is.
You know, some of this activity. That's like a cyber dog.
Mm-hmm.
And then the child that you see in the lower left insert is operating these hand tools that give you hands within the virtual world.
Right.
So as he turns his head, the situation changes. I think he is in a program called the lab. And in the lab is like different things you can do with science experiments. Is that right, Scott?
It is very immersive.
Yeah, is the word.
You forget where you're standing and sitting, and you are surrounded by that, and that's where you are. Is
now,
that
here's
blue?
Here's an example of one of my favorites, which is blue. And this one looks like it's like the deep water dark, where the hand tools, they act as flashlights.
Oh, yeah. So you have these hand tools that allow you to do things.
In the virtual world.
In the virtual world. Not.
Yeah. So it's suitable
really neat.
Enough for our age group and adults.
Yes, there's nothing inappropriate.
Yeah, I mean, I wish it would work better, too, with littler kids, but it's just not their size.
Right.
So kids 9 to 13 are invited to come to MCAT every Saturday from 1 to 5. Your added incentive is that when you take a break, you can look at the virtual world.
Right.
And we thought it was important on a number of fronts, one being that it would be used as a training tool real commonly in the future, so mm-hmm. we've been told. And we wanted, to further prevent that digital divide where people that don't have the means, like this outfit was about $3,200, would never be exposed to this technology until it became a serious situation,
right.
Like put on the VR and...
Virtual reality costs real money.
Yeah, that's right.
But it's free if you come down to MCAT.
Yeah, that's right. It's part of that package. There's a $10 fee for the Saturday animation. It covers 4 hours of activity, including now virtual reality.
That's really neat.
The biggest news. If people watching want to learn more about MCAT, if they think that they would like to make a program on the second Wednesday of every month at 5:30, no reservation required, you can come down and get a tour.
Yeah.
And a little like sense of our inventory and how nice we are.
Yeah. Welcoming.
If you did want to call and learn more about it, 542-6228, and you can go to MCAT.org and learn more about us that way.
That's great.
Yeah, and they should like our Facebook page.
And
we're
go
to
our Facebook page. Oh, we're doing good.
Yeah, I need 10 more to get to 1,200 likes.
Okay.
10 more.
Go to the Facebook page, and then you'll get little notices when something new happens.
Yeah. Oh, and you've got coming up.
Yes, Humanities Montana has been recently introduced a whole new catalog of programs that will help communities talk about current events, especially social justice issues.
Yeah, there's a lot of it.
And bringing people who are, of the communities that are being affected by social justice issues. So on Thursday, March 9th, there it is, we are going to have in our current state program at Imagination Brewery, which has just been a great partner and a great new addition to right. our community. They're a nonprofit.
Yes.
They are a nonprofit, and they consider themselves an educational center that brews beer.
Okay.
They didn't.
Why not?
So anyway, the Our Current State discussion that's coming up on March 9th is at 6 o'clock at Imagination, and it's on social justice and our legal system. And it will feature Kevin Kicking Woman, James Steele Jr., and they're going to talk about why, for instance, Native Americans are so overrepresented in our criminal justice system, and what societal the setups and stereotypes contribute to that in terms of our culture at large, and then aspects of the legal system. So it'll be a good conversation. They're going to give us a little background, but then it's really wide open to talk. And the last talk we had, it was standing room only at Imagination. Everyone was involved in talking and engaged. And it feels good to tackle some important issues.
Is there a fee for people to go?
Oh, no, it's free. It's you like, have to buy your beer if you want beer.
Yeah, I guess that would be it. And then it's right across from Pavarello on
yes.
West Broadway.
And the popcorn's free.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah,
all right. Well, our first guest is here.
Very patiently waiting.
Yeah, Jesse, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Jesse's Development Director at the Historical Museum at Fort Missoula, and you've been working on so many events.
Yes.
Let's take some for a spin. And we have graphics. We have graphics that you provided to us that Scott's loaded in there.
Oh,
so here's one. I don't know, maybe it's not in the right order, though.
And that's fine. So the entire month of March, we're calling Making Memories in March. And the Historical Museum's real goal in this next year is to just get out into the public and let the folks know that we're not your normal historical museum. We're breaking down barriers, and we're doing new and cool things. Tons of youth programs, senior programs, educational programs, and just having fun and getting people excited about their history and being involved in it. So we're kicking off spring, which means we have been working overtime all winter, especially our curator, Nicole, who, in addition to all of the exhibits and things that she does on a daily basis, has had to create two brand new exhibits for me in a style that is not your typical historical museum style. This is really kind of modern and colorful and completely different than what we've standardly done. So I've been definitely making her work overtime. So kudos to Nicole.
Nice.
Way to go. Thank you. I'll buy you a beer or five.
And you're having a lot of beer.
Yes, and a lot of these have to do with beer, so
right.
it
That's
works.
Perfect.
So the month of March, we kick off at the Dram Shop with a First Friday event. And the First Friday event is literally, we are doing a history of beer art exhibit. So we are creating a history of beer in general, Montana beer, and then individual types of beer, your ales versus your lagers, your stouts, your sours, your Hefeweizens, mm-hmm. all of these, and a little bit of history on each of these and their own colorful panel. They'll be laid out, and then we'll also have art from a local artist who's creating a Montana beer, basically a poster for us to be able to sell, but it's a really cool art piece. I'm not going to let too much slip. It will be for sale there, and it's going to be a special thing for the Historical Museum, and it's, so far in the sketches I've seen, it's looking pretty awesome.
Oh, that's cool, and it will be unveiled at the Dram Shop?
It will be unveiled at the Dram Shop on the first Friday in March.
That's cool.
And so we'll be there, we'll be having fun, we got raffles and swag, and you know, beer will be pouring out. Each event we do, there'll be a raffle from the Dram, you know, come in, get a bucket ticket, get your hopefully nice huge raffle prize. There's a lot of different folks throwing in for the raffle for each event, so each one will be special. And then the very next day at Imagination Brewing, which is March 4th, is the unveiling of our next new huge project program, which is called Missoula Memories, taking a walk through the decades. So the Missoula Memory Project is really exciting for us because it is, again, going outside of the normal walls of a museum. We've created a memory booth. And the booth is where you can go in and through a tablet can record your own memory. It doesn't have to be historically significant. We're all making our own history every day. And many cultures collect and pass down their oral traditions and history and stories of grandpa and things like that through oral tradition. And that is something that we decided as a museum that we were lacking in. We collect objects, we collect, you know, archives. We have an amazing collection of 40,000 plus objects. But then we hear people talking, they'll come out to an event, they tell us this amazing story, and then it's gone.
Right. Because when you see those pieces,
they create,
it generates stories. I mean, you
right.
remember.
And that's why it's the Missoula Memory Project, where we have a memory booth where people can record a story, but we also have the Taking the Walk Through the Decades exhibit,
right.
which goes from the 1900s all the way to current times. So each of these different panels, again, it's colorful, it's artistic, it's different, it's full of pop culture. I mean, what was the top-selling album in 1997? Come to Missoula Memories and find out.
Right. I
might give you a hint and say it's mbop, mbop, but, you know.
Doing cat there.
And so it's going to be a really fun event. It starts at noon, so the actual exhibit and memory booth, artifacts, we'll have games there that people can bring out on the table and try to like figure out and like try to beat each other on the games. So that starts at noon when Imagination opens.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have an open mic and storytelling starting at around 5-ish, where we'll have a few storytellers lined up, and these are just people, I'll be up there telling my story of Missoula, and it's just not Missoula, it's Montana, Bitterroot, Butte, whatever mm-hmm. story you want to tell. It's about your experience as a human being. And so we'll have open mic, we'll have a few folks getting up there talking. IMDC is being awesome, and for every brew we get 50 cents, which is really cool. We'll have, like I said, a bunch of games, a great exhibit. It's going to be a ton of fun.
Yeah.
And that event starts at 5, but the whole exhibit and memory booth will be there all day long.
Oh, great.
So,
and then that's not it.
No, that's not it.
Right.
There's more.
So much more. And I'm not tired at all. So that's the first 2 days of March.
Mm-hmm.
And then that following week, about the following week, I think the next one will be the HMFM 70s kegger. So we're doing a throwback kegger at the dram shop. And we're going to have
Arbor Day
keggers ran during the 70s, and it was a big, great fundraiser. It was the biggest fundraising kegger in the nation.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not exactly like going straight on Arbor Day, because we don't want to overshadow them.
No.
We're having our own kegger. There's going to be great 70s music. The kegger documentary will be on display, just because it is so awesome.
Right.
I mean, if you see truckloads of kegs just like rolling down a plank and seeing people with milk jugs just like guzzling with mullets, and it's just wonderful.
The fashion alone.
I mean, it's 70s
Missoula.
Were
you around for that?
I never went.
Oh, you never went, but
I was
you could have gone.
I was a high school student.
Yeah, well, you shouldn't have gone, but you could have gone.
But it's going to be a lot of fun. And the nice thing is so we've got a few breweries in town who are donating some kegs, and we're going to tap those kegs, and all the proceeds from those kegs go to your historical museum.
This is great.
It is a fundraiser, but it's going to be fun. So definitely, like, if you feel like it, throw on your platforms, grab your leisure suit, come down and, you know, get boogie with it.
You're cut off
so
denim.
Flannel shirts, I remember seeing.
Yes.
Cut off Wranglers.
Yeah.
Because it was a kind of spring celebration, wasn't
mm-hmm.
it?
It was usually a big mud pit.
Right. Because it was the spring.
It was like Missoula's version of Woodstock.
Without
Jimi Hendrix.
It wasn't held right in town. It was somewhere.
It was up on Miller Creek.
Instead of Jimi Hendrix, we had a Mission Mountain Wood Band.
Because PBS did a great special, right, about the.
And so we'll have that. Like I said, we're going to have some music. I mean, not live music, but there'll be music there.
Yeah.
And it's just going to be a party.
That'll
and come down
fun.
And have fun. And then, 2 days after that.
Good Lord, are they going to rest?
Never.
Again, at the dram shop. I mean, this is kind of like the dram most of the month, except for the Missoula event. We have HMFM pub trivia. So come down and see if you can outsmart the historians. And it's going to be epic. We got Fun Snacks, our MC. She's been running pub trivia for over 10 years.
Oh, wow.
And she's going to be hosting the show. It's going to be a lot of fun. It's a two-hour show, and we're going to throw in some real difficult ones. ones, but you can buy hints and you can buy mulligans.
Interesting.
Cool. And you can just come down, you know, bring your friends. There's table sets, so you can have like 4 to 6 people on a team. Come down, have a good time. There will be fun snacks available along with alcohol, mm-hmm. so it'll be a really good time, plus a bunch of fun pub trivia. The Decades exhibit will be out in all of these events, so once it comes down from imagination, we're gonna have like tabletop displays of different fun trivia and things, so if you're in the know, you'll know to check out all the displays, because some of it might be tied to some of the questions, just throwing that out there.
And, it's a hint, right?
Hint. And so that's going to be a ton of fun. And then, so that's 5 events,
yes.
I believe.
Yes, and there's something involving punch cards.
Yes. So.
Oh, good on you to remember.
Yes. So basically, we have these punch cards, and they list all these events. And we'll be handing them out at the first Friday and at Imagination and at some of them. And basically, you keep that card. And if you come to at least 3 out of 5 of the events, mm-hmm. then the Dram Shop is having their second year birthday party on the 25th of March. So they've been around for 2 years. So if you come to at least 3 of our events, come over to the HMFM table, we'll sign your card, you bring that, you get a free drink at the Dram Shop on their birthday party.
Oh, hence the punch card.
Yes, it's so clever.
So that's it's really a way, you know, idea. Just come to 3 of our events. Oh, I forgot the tasting.
Oh,
that's
no.
why there's 5. Okay, so yes, after the pub trivia.
Right, but before the punch card thing.
Before the punch card thing. So pub trivia kind of kicks off it's St. Patty's Day week,
oh, right.
so that flows in too. So the Wednesday after that, on the 22nd, we are having what I think is pretty cool. We're having a Trailblazer Flight of Beer kind of event, so it's a tasting. And basically, we are going to celebrate the Montana brewery pioneers. So the Dram Shop is going out there and talking to all the like really original brewers that have been in Montana and Missoula for, you know, several decades. And then they're going to have a selection of different beers that are like these breweries' primary beer. And then there's going to be history on each of these beers. So you'll go up, you'll pay your $15 to get your flight. And I think Zach was saying the flight was going to be between like 6 and 8 beers. Mm-hmm. So that's pretty dang good.
Yeah.
And we get a portion of the proceeds. But you go up, you get your flight, you get your beer, you get a little history flyer on that beer to learn about it and all that stuff. All the art will still be up, the exhibit will still be up. We'll be there talking about history of beer and having fun, and maybe throwing in some trivia too. And so it's another great way to learn about your state, hang out with some friends, drink some good beer, support your local historical museum, and again, get your punch card punched because right. 3 days after that, we have the birthday bash at
right.
the Dram Shop, so where you can cash in your punch card for a free beer.
Wow, you guys have orchestrated a lot.
This is a busy month. That is way too much for me or anybody else to keep
so
track of.
So go to Facebook.
Right.
Oh,
go
is that better than our website?
Okay. All the events are up on Facebook.
Good.
Our website is in the middle of being completely redone, so it's not the place to go.
No.
So go to Facebook.
Right.
All of the events are in there. Click interested, click going, so it can keep you alerted.
Yeah.
You know, in addition, in March, we've got the homeschool after school, I think on the 23rd, where it's a drop-in class, the learning about Women's History Matters and about Jeanette Rankin. Mm. And then we have a weaving heritage craft event on the 31st of March.
Oh, which, I'd like to see
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it's a drop-in, so you can come in and learn how to weave and know how that's going to happen. I think in like 3 days, you'll have to check Facebook, don't quote me on this, we're having not weaving, but another heritage craft that's really cool.
That's like
spinning.
Weaving.
Is it spinning?
No, weaving is this week. Spinning is in March. There we go.
Because they're connected. Yeah.
Yeah. It's weaving or spinning, one of those two.
Right.
They will
the
both be happening.
The
yeah.
Go to Facebook. It's on there. Like Historical Museum at Fort Missoula. We have
right.
so many events going on. Just go there. If you have questions, send us a message. We're pretty good about getting back to you. Give us a call. Shoot us an email. We're having a lot of fun, and we're really getting out in the community, so.
Every single one of those events just sound like a ball.
They really
we wanted them all to be different, but really fun
yeah.
and tied together
yeah.
in some way.
Well, you've done an amazing job. I can't wait to go to them.
Good.
That sounds
well,
great.
Well, we look forward to seeing you. All right, thank you for having
thank
me.
Thank you.
Yes.
So we've got more guests. I've seen them out there. Scott's going to show you a public service announcement, and we'll be right back.
MCAT.
Legos. Legos.
Peppa Pow.
No.
From yet to VR, virtual reality is what we are.
Editing. Editing.
Hoverboard.
Green screen. Legos. Editing. Editing.
Come get your VR. Virtual reality is what we are.
Hoverboard. Green screen.
Missoula Community Access Television works with kids in an...
And we're back. And then we're going to do that. Right. And then we're like...
Senior Corps at Missoula Aging Services is Missoula's volunteer hub. Hundreds of volunteer opportunities await. You can help improve reading skills, school attendance, and the well-being of students. Provide services that help older adults. Or find out about countless other opportunities that will capture your interest. Because your heart's desire never ages, now is the time to reinvent yourself. Discover your perfect volunteer opportunity by calling 728-7682.
For too long, corporate tobacco has exploited our people, manipulated our practices, and profited from our addiction. No more. If you struggle with commercial tobacco addiction, call the American Indian Commercial Tobacco Quit Line today at 1-855-372-00.
Okay, we are back. Feel free to introduce yourselves because you're so many.
Look at this couch.
Yeah. Well, everyone is here to talk about Diversity Week.
Yep. So I'm Nicole Mitchell. I'm with the Flagship Program.
I'm Melissa Madsen. I'm the Flagship Coordinator for Big Sky High School and Willard Alternative High School.
Oh.
I'm Emily Sandersfeld, and I'm the Flagship Coordinator at Hellgate High School.
Right. And I'm Michael Workman. I am the Festival Coordinator at the Big Sky Documentary Film Festival.
Excellent. Thank you. Well, there's probably so much going on. I just read in the paper that I thought this year Big Sky was doing Diversity Week after some... No, Sentinel was doing Diversity Week after some time off that they hadn't done in the past.
Yeah.
But who wants to define it for...
Yeah.
Oh, the viewership.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Diversity Week started in 2005 at Big Sky High School through Flagship. And it partnered with Hellgate High School as well. And they were just looking for some more things to bring into the schools. And we reached out to Big Sky Documentary Film Festival and started partnering with them way back in 2005, and I've been doing a collaboration of bringing filmmakers and films to the schools through Diversity Week ever since. And it's kind of evolved and grown, and now it has like its own program called Filmmakers in the Schools.
Great.
Yeah, it's really cool.
So how does it work? Are the filmmakers chosen because they're representing different underrepresented groups or issues of people getting along together from different backgrounds?
Yeah. It kind of,
you guys can speak on that.
Yeah.
You guys are more involved in the selection of the filmmakers in the school side of things.
Okay.
We get the offerings, and we take a look at films. And we think about our groups of students at the school. You know, and we're trying to piece together certain concepts that would speak to the school and their needs at the time, and then see if we can put panels together that can discuss these. So, it's a little bit of a puzzle, putting it together for your student body, really.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And is this going on both at Sentinel and Big Sky, or at Big Sky and Hugging? And Willard.
And I may be wrong, but I think it's back at Sentinel.
Well,
but I read this thing line.
They hadn't done it, and now
they're doing it.
Yeah. Because we're giving them a bunch of speakers.
Oh, are you?
Yeah.
Okay.
But does Diversity Week always coincide with the Documentary Film Festival?
It does. Yeah.
How convenient.
Yeah. Perfect.
So what are some of the kinds of films or panels that are going to be going on?
I'll start. I had three films this morning. One was a Montana film about a country western singer who has bipolar disorder. Another one was a short film about Hobo that kind of rides the rails, and another one was about a barber who cuts the hair of the homeless. So the panel was kind of revolved around mental health, addiction, and homelessness. And sort of, I showed the show three films, and then I had a representative from Alateen, two people from the Salvation Army. They just built that new center that is a teen area. I had a project success coordinator. And then I had the filmmakers who actually shot the film with the guy riding the rails. So not only was it about, you know, compassion and health and understanding of these issues, but also how do you document it? How does this come to being? So that was one of the panels that I had this morning. Emily.
So each year at Hellgate, we do a different theme. This year, our theme is overcoming conflict and establishing harmony. So all the films are sort of around that concept. Some of them are larger things, like we had Roadside Radiation, which is about Chernobyl, and now there's people that are still living there, there's someone that works there, and you know how they're dealing with that past and the present. Mm-hmm. And we'll show some environmental ones. There's Scylla and the Gatekeepers of the Arctic, and that's the Inuit tribes and with the melting ice, and so it follows them, and then it's on the other side are these scientists and what they're doing and how they're documenting it, and you know, how are they overcoming now that they don't really have the cold and the ice like they used to, and it's a whole new way of life. And so we just have this wealth of things that are, you know, more widespread to individual. You know, the guys next door, which follows a gay couple and how they are adopting two children through a surrogate mother, and their friend is actually the surrogate, and so it's like their individual challenge.
There's also a Diversity Week celebration, isn't that right, at the Senior Citizen Center? Typically, or there's a get together at some point, or is that later? I'm thinking Scott's wagging his head. No.
There's a diversity day.
Yes, that's what I'm thinking of. That Empower Montana does.
And that happens in the spring, in the warmer time.
Yeah. That's a good idea.
We work with Empower Montana as well, so they're going to come and do a workshop for us at Hellgate on Friday.
Oh, nice.
I figured you guys would be partnering in some way. Mm-hmm. Michael, what about doing this with the high schools was appealing to the Big Sky Documentary Film Festival?
Well, I think for us, it's like we want to get our films out, and I think it adds value for the filmmakers who are coming to connect to an audience that, I mean, the kids really value the experience of it, mm-hmm. and they value the experience of showing it to the kids or the students. And I think also that for us, it's a part of our mission for the Film Institute is in media literacy. So it provides that part of it is we really get to get out into these schools where we can actually, you know, affect the students' way of looking at the world, you know, or giving them new and valuable perspectives. And I think it's also a good thing because they almost don't necessarily get to choose what they're going to, you know, it's not something that's necessarily something that they can just pick out of and that will reaffirm whatever they already believe, but it can be something that challenges them intellectually and hopefully grows them.
Because so many times that's happened to me going to the film festival is, I've, you know, there's some big, you know, big name things that you go, oh, I'm definitely going to go see that.
Yeah.
But often it's the things that just take you by surprise, you know, the, right. the mm-hmm. three short films that are in before right. something else, mm-hmm. where you just go, whoa, I never would have seen that.
Yeah.
So it's smart. And you're creating the next generation audience, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I started in high school around that time that it started, mm-hmm. too. So I went to Hellgate, yeah. and now I work here, so.
And now it's your life.
There you go.
I kind of developed this cool program. I don't know if you want to talk about that, about the teen docs or the
program. Yeah, yeah. Program. Well, I can't take credit for it, because when I was in high school, it had started, and that's how I got involved, but it's basically a program, it's called the Big Sky Youth Fellowship, Big Sky Documentary Youth Fellowship, and we work with like 4 to 5 high school students in Missoula for 6 months, and they create like a short documentary that screens, so those are screening on Thursday. So they work for a really long time, they have to learn about history of documentary, and they have to learn about like theory involved in it and stuff, and then actually making something, so production side and editing, and it's a full-on kind of experience, and that's how I got involved. And then the program kind of went away, and then I brought it back a few years ago with the help of MCAT.
Oh yeah.
So yeah.
Good job there.
Yeah, so you need the helping with the equipment and
yeah,
everything
right.
getting to the kids.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Yep.
So programming is going on for the rest of this week, is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yep. So each school puts together like a whole lineup. So Emily, you can kind of show the brochure.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Yeah. So each period of every day throughout the week has something that teachers can sign up for.
Mm-hmm. Wow. And so they can look through and then they choose, you know, like, oh, this fits in with what the students are currently learning. Mm-hmm. And they come and it's a presentation or a film. And it's really great to have the filmmakers there. The students get to ask them questions. And a lot of times the students, they come up with these questions that, yeah. you know, we wouldn't normally even think of. They're
right.
just really insightful. And, you know, I like that all the students are looking at the world in a different way.
Yeah, yeah. The kids must love it.
A break from the routine.
Yeah.
Do they see it as some sort of cultural medicine? Some of them are like, oh, I've got to learn about diversity, I don't want to. Or do you think there's some conflict where they think it's politicizing or, you know, that kind of thing?
You know, some students that may approach it better, that I think that is a exception, not the norm.
Yeah.
I think all of the students today really appreciated the range of films and just see, I mean, they're all so current.
Mm-hmm.
These are films that are, some of them are hot off the press.
Yeah, I mean, some of them are first few
so
days ago.
Brand new that this is really information that's relevant to these kids at this time. So, yeah, I don't know.
I
think it's an opportunity to open their eyes and, like was said, you know, give them a different perspective on
right.
a different current issue.
Yeah, so there's a strong sense of enthusiasm for it at each of the high schools.
Yeah. It was like, Melissa had like 300 people at, you know, most of her presentations
wow.
today.
So every you know, the teachers sign up.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know, you always worry. My periods are an hour and a half of holding a teenager's interest
yeah.
with the documentary film and a discussion, and really the kids were so respectful. And as Emily said, some of the conversations and comments they make are like, wow,
yeah,
that is really cool. So yeah,
it's impressive then that
yeah.
way. And you guys have to put a lot of work into providing this opportunity for the week, right?
It's got
to
be a huge organization.
You coordinate with the principals, the deans, the teachers,
and work with Big Sky
yeah.
Documentary.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, juggle.
Yeah, so Sarah,
yeah.
Right.
Sarah Briggs helps us like coordinate all the filmmakers, all the films through filmmakers in the
mm-hmm.
schools. Yeah, it is a big production, a lot of planning.
I bet.
Yeah.
Lord, love ya. Well, do you guys want to go? I mean, you might think of something else you want to cover or say. And then, I don't know, Michael, if you wanted to stay during the break, then we could highlight the Big Sky,
yeah,
and
sure.
then we'll bring
yeah,
Chase out for
right.
the zero waste.
Yeah, sounds great.
All right. So Scott's talking to Josh, but I guess he's paying attention. He's like, oh, I'm paying attention.
Yeah.
Josh is like, yeah, he's paying attention. So you could break and show them like your PSA about our virtual reality,
And we'll be right back with Michael Workman. We'll talk about Big Sky Documentary Film Festival and show you that website because there's so many films to see.
Yeah.
So we'll be right back and thank you all for coming.
Yeah. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, you know it.
Yeah.
At Missoula Aging Services, you'll always be greeted with a warm welcome. Whether you are caring for an aging loved one or you're an older adult yourself, our friendly staff is ready to connect you to the help you need. You will always get unbiased advice, a free assessment of your needs, and personalized information about the resources available. See what we can do for you. Call 728-7682 or log on to MissoulaAgingServices.org.
And we're back with us, Michael Workman, because we could talk just about Big Sky Documentary Film Festival. BSDFF.
Yeah, BSDFF. Today, I mean, you might be watching this some other day, but it right now, in my world, it's Tuesday.
That's right, the 22nd.
February 21st. And how many days remain when the film festival, Michael?
5 days, I believe. Yeah, this is day five, so... Yeah, we're a 10-day event, so
halfway
there. Yeah.
Tell people a little bit, you know, about it in broad terms as though they never heard of it.
Right.
So the Big Sky Documentary Film Festival is a 10-day documentary film fest. So we screen films from shorts to minis to 80 minutes, you know, we screen a variety of lengths of different films of all different subjects. Over 10 days at 5 different venues, so just a lot of screenings going on. There's around 200 filmmakers and industry professionals that come out. So there's a huge influx of filmmakers that come out, and then a lot of crowds that come out. And we put films in front of them.
And you guys also do like the doc shop, like panels and workshops about making documentary films and getting started and the ethics thereof, and distributors come and talk about.
Yeah, we have a Big Sky pitch. Well, we have two pitches this year where people come and during doc shop and they pitch their ideas to funders that come out, and they have like 20 minutes total to pitch their idea and get feedback from the panel of funders, and some people get funding from it, and some people get feedback, and it's a really interesting thing.
Yeah. It's an extraordinary event, you know, and I feel very privileged to see it, like from its beginning, when it was an idea, it seemed like Drew Carr, Doug Hawes-Davies, these guys made documentaries for years of their own, and then around the turn of the century, Doug was saying, oh, we should put on a documentary film festival, and it seemed like a worthy idea. People didn't watch, you know, like when I did the Crystal Theater those 15 years, there would be something like My Brother's Keeper, which was a documentary about three brothers, and one of them was killed, and did one brother kill the other? It was extraordinary courtroom drama.
Once in a while, there would be a big break.
Thin Blue Line.
Right.
Was this guy guilty of a crime or not? Much like The Making of a Murderer was now, but shorter, you know, because it was a film. But that documentary was this teeny subgenre that I guess Doug and Drew, because they'd made so many, they're like, let's have this as a festival and really bring it up. And it's extraordinary to see its success.
Yeah, it's hugely popular. And like the popularity of documentaries is just growing, like in the global sphere too.
Yeah. All my kids watch.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Interesting. And I've noticed like on the Netflix, for instance, one example of a place, I bet it's cheaper to get a documentary, you know, for distribution, to get the rights of it, than it might be to get a large photo play, you know, a drama that costs millions of dollars. So there seems to be more documentaries in on-demand circulation.
Yeah.
And people really enjoy seeing them, and it's sort of a way that people are learning more about life through the TV when they should really go out and do it. It's almost like the virtuous characteristic of dealing with the virtual.
Right.
So you'd say, Well, I'm watching a movie, but at least a documentary, I'm learning something.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Whereas fiction seems to be escapist.
Yeah.
This is like engagist or something.
Yeah.
Now, what are some of the big popular or exciting things you think are still ahead?
I mean, there's lots of films. We have and there's also a special event we're doing tomorrow at MCT, which is like a multimedia dance performance film.
So oh, wow.
It's about like cancer survivors. And so it basically is a series of projections and dances around those and these interviews. So it's like this mix of documentary and dance. But we even have like lots of exciting screenings coming up tonight even. Like we're screening a film called Off the Rails about a guy who basically hijacks all of the public transportation around New York City just because he loves trains and buses.
That really happened?
Yeah, he's been arrested about 30 times, and he just wants to, he wants to control and conduct the trains very efficiently. He's just like kind of obsessed and loves the trains, and they won't. The New York City Transportation Department won't hire him.
So he just
keeps going. He's freelancing.
Yeah, exactly.
In and out of jail and freelancing.
Right.
Yes.
But I think anyone who's attended the festival could come away with a story, you know, a real life story that they remember from any time that they went.
Oh yeah.
You know,
absolutely.
Because to my mind came the story of the Helena football player guy who had a gender reassignment,
it turns
out like his parents were like, I can't, you know, like Orson Welles and Rita Hayworth or something, because he was really adopted. But when I saw that movie in the crowd, you know, people gasped, you know, at the turn of events and so on. And it's a story just like I can remember that everyone in that room has probably told someone years later at some point, because they're like, once I learned this really weird thing.
Yeah, you know? Totally.
And it would be a film from the documentary film festival.
Yeah.
That's great though that you have that memory of like the theater experience, because I think festivals are one of the last things that are getting people back in theaters.
Yeah,
true.
It is really true.
And the BSDFF happens all over downtown Missoula, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's not just at the Wilma or what are the other venues?
So we're at the Wilma, we're at the Roxy, we're also at the Hellgate Elks Lodge. We built a pop-up theater in the second floor, which is really cool.
Good.
I love that space up there.
Yeah, it's
and
really
they did
cool.
That just for history, for the record, that the theater that was known as the Golden
Silver.
Horn,
yeah.
And then the World Theater in my day, beginning in 1983, where I saw The Dresser that year.
Oh, yeah, I remember that movie.
And then turned into nothing, sort of, after Carmike bought it and said it couldn't be a movie theater.
Yeah.
And then it was like a religious, it was called The World, as
a
religious, like a church.
Yeah.
And MCAT did some recording of Christian talent shows in there at the turn of this century. And then the Silver Foundation took it over, and then the roof collapsed within the last month from all the snow.
A week before the
yeah.
was
a- and they had
yeah,
just
the
fixed it up.
Yeah, they were in the process of fixing it up. Yep.
So that probably made all of your worlds a little more tense.
Right?
Luckily.
The venue collapsed.
Yeah, luckily.
And you're also at the Public House, right?
Yeah, we'll be at the Public House for 2 days. We're building a pop-up theater in there also.
Great.
Yep.
Wow,
and the Roxy and the Hellgate Lodge.
Right. And MCT. Which,
right.
Yeah.
And MCT.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So there's still 5 more days of stuff to going on, and it's all on the website, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and Scott showed people a little bit of the website, you know, because there's so many movies. And then you still show the best of, right? So that towards the end of the week, there'll be votes, and then...
Well, so this year we're screening all of our competition stuff twice. So we're not doing an award screening this year.
Oh, okay.
But we're doing we will have them screen again. So the awards ceremony, or the people who win our competitions, that happens on Friday. And then there's also an audience award that's going around.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's a great, great 10-day extravaganza. Thank
yeah, congratulations at getting halfway.
You grew up with it, essentially.
Yeah, yeah.
Isn't that cool?
Yeah, because I remember when Mike was, you know, he was a teenager, not the man he is now. And he was coming here and taking equipment out for that teen doc weekend and everything.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, good luck with the rest
yeah,
of
it. Yeah, thank you, Michael.
Guys. Yeah, thanks for having me.
We still have a guest, you guys. That is Chase Jones. He's here to talk about waste management, sustainable activity within government. He's up right next.
Welcome, my friends, to Missoula Community Access Television, MCAT. And here, every Saturday afternoon, we're having a drop-in animation camp, and where you can do such wonderful things as do animating things of great all endeavors, like make Legos come to life. Or like this! Just do that! It'll be amazing! Here, at MCAT, 500 North Higgins, Suite 105, every Saturday afternoon, 1 p.m. to 5 p.m.
Your local library. Igniting the passion for reading.
How would you like to have an endless supply of books, movies, music, audiobooks, and even ebooks whenever you want? Your library card can do all that, and it doesn't cost a thing. You can pick up a library card anytime the library is open, free of charge to residents. All you need is a picture ID with your current address. The library will then verify your address, and once they have, your library card will be good for life. Library card holders may borrow several items to enjoy all at once. Be sure to check the return dates as they may vary depending on what items you check out. It's so easy to get access to all the library has to offer, and best of all, it's free. To learn more, stop by your local library or visit their website.
When we are back with Chase Jones. You were about to pose
now
a question.
You can tell us.
Yes, what?
I just want to make sure that I'm looking at both of you.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, we just tell.
We were telling right. people that. But, you know, sometimes you could look right into that camera okay. if you wanted to address the home audience.
Okay.
And we do,
hello,
right, exactly. We do yeah. typically just to say hello and goodbye. Well, Chase Jones, representing yes. the city of Missoula, could you explain to people, you know, the initiative to have this zero waste by the year 2050?
Yeah, I'm here to talk today about our zero waste initiative called Zero by 50, or Missoula's Pathway to Zero Waste. And it started about a year ago when City Council passed a resolution adopting a waste reduction goal of 90% for the community of Missoula by the year 2050, hence the year, or the name Zero by 50.
Right.
That seems extremely ambitious to me, to have zero waste in a community. Can you talk about like how that's achieved?
I can. And some of the events will also inform us on the strategies on how to achieve that. But zero waste, that concept really is kind of taking the traditionally linear process of we want things, we buy things, we use part of that resource, and then we just throw it away. And it magically goes away. And so zero waste kind of turns that on its head, and it sort of rethinks and redesigns policies and processes and infrastructure so that we reduce our consumption first, and then we find ways to reuse things instead of just discarding them. We recycle them third, and then if we do all of those things sort of in that order, if you will, and together, then we'll send very little or nothing to the landfill. And I know that makes it sound very simple. It's super complex. It will take many years and phases, but it's an important enough thing to work on, and the benefits to our community are great enough to get started. And yeah. it really is in response to this community groundswell that came out of all of these groups that have been working on this for years.
Oh, interesting.
It's yeah.
Now, see, when Chase was talking, you know, I was doing the mental math. I was doing the 23 years from today, February 21st, you say, 2017. A Tuesday, it was wet and cold. But I was thinking back to these other cultural changes. One is littering. So yeah. I cannot really remember, but I was born in 58, so let's say 10 years later in 1968 as a 10-year-old boy, I think it was pretty routine traveling in a car with my parents, who were good people. And the cars, you know, they had the fly window, which takes right. you back, that weird little one. They would throw stuff out that window. They would just yeah. do it. They'd be like, my dad was smoking, there's six kids in the car.
Sure.
And then he'd like, just flick it out there. My mother would undo some gum wrapper. Whoa, that kind of thing. Now, sure. nowadays, that would be crazy. Or if we were sitting here with like little tinfoil ashtrays, you know, like, oh, wow, zero yeah. waste, that sounds great.
Yeah.
It would be totally weird.
Yeah.
That's
and
right.
yet, when I was, for instance, a graduate student at University of Montana, 83 to 86, we smoked in there all the time.
Sure.
All the time. Like the teacher would come up for a little art critique and we'd like sit there and then we would take that butt, we'd throw it on the floor and we'd grind it out with our shoe.
Sure.
So other things can happen.
Yeah, and learning happens. And, you know, social norms can change when we learn that some of those things that we just have always done have adverse effects on our health, on our community, and that we can do things differently and live a higher quality of life. And I think this is another example of that learning and of that progress.
Yeah, yeah. So there's specifically listening sessions coming up, isn't that right?
That's correct, mm-hmm. yeah. So we have some ideas of sort of the basic things that go into a plan for zero waste. Mm-hmm. But we want to hear from our community because, again, this is a result and a response to this community groundswell.
Right.
We know lots of people in Missoula are concerned, have great ideas, and we can learn a lot from them. And so we want to host, we're hosting three community listening sessions, March 2nd at the Missoula Federal Credit Union Training Center over on Brook Street, mm-hmm. March 7th at the Burn Street Center over on the west side, and then the last on March 8th at the Missoula Public Library in the large meeting room. And we're going to gather folks together and we're going to tell them about the zero waste concept and the goals that our city has set sort of as a learning thing for people who show up and know nothing about zero waste.
Yeah.
And then we're going to break into small groups and we're going to dialogue and we're going to ask questions and we're going to listen to community members basically around three pretty basic questions, but will really inform the plan going forward. And you know, those questions are, why do you care? What are the barriers? And what can we do to achieve our goals? Mm-hmm. And we think we're going to learn a lot, as we always do in a lot of these public processes. We have such a brilliant, engaged community, and yeah. it's a pleasure to serve.
So people want to go, they can choose their location. If they live that way, Brooks, that way Burns.
Missoula.
That was intentional, library. Actually. Yeah, we thought that we would host them in different parts of town, so in theory it was easier for folks to get to.
Sure.
Yeah.
We have the dates on the TV screen right now.
Oh, good. Thanks, Scott.
And for people who don't have a chance to write those dates down or want to look into it a little more, there's a website they can go to find out more?
There is a website. Hopefully it's easy to remember. It's the name. It's 0by50missoula.com.
Is zero spelled out with a Z, E-R-O?
And 50 as well, F-I-F-T-Y.
Oh, wow.
Okay. So no numbers.
Yeah, it's like all those letters.
That's zero right.
0by50missoula.com.
Com.
Well, and all of the information and more than we discussed today is on that website.
See, a lot of the times, I don't know how much time you have, because my thing, my Fitbit's broken.
4 minutes.
Oh, okay. A lot of times, people look to the manufacturer. Like I know here at MCAT, when I get electronics, right? So it's shipped and I got the box, and then inside the box, I've seen it change, you know, from those diabolical peanuts, those styrofoam peanuts.
Sure.
Everyone hated them, they floated all around, and you just wanted to put them in a trash bag and get them in the trash. It always seems such a shame, but they were little and irritating. And then it moved into like little air pillows, you know?
Yep.
And you could score them with your box cutter, mm-hmm. and they would flatten. And then you could recycle that plastic.
And
so that was an enormous change.
Right.
Oh, you got a new one?
Well,
packaging?
Now they're doing a lot of recycled material that is actually, and that decomposes really, really quickly.
Oh, okay.
More organic and natural.
So there lots of innovation going on around packaging, and packaging is one of those major things, and a big reason to reduce consumption in general. But another part of reducing is just being aware of your packaging and choosing products that have less
absolutely
packaging.
I found myself becoming much more aware of that, all that plastic and stuff around a box this
right
big, and really consciously trying to, in the supermarket or wherever.
That's right.
You know, if you have the bulk option, do that. You've got your own bag that you brought.
You know? You got it. And education goes a long way in all of these efforts.
So after these conversations, you're going to be coming back to Missoulians.
That's right.
With what?
So we'll host our listening sessions March 2nd, 7th, and 8th, as we discussed. We'll take all of that great information and we'll draft a plan. That's kind of the end goal of this. And then once we have a plan, we'll go back out to the community for public comment, and we'll hear from them again on how we did, if we listened well, if we incorporated their concerns and their ideas, and if they think we're on the right track. And then we'll incorporate all of that good feedback. So the draft is in July. We'll go out for public comment sort of through the early fall. And then we'll finish up the draft, dot all the I's and cross all the T's, and hopefully bring it to council and the community for adoption by the end of this calendar year.
Mm. Are other communities doing this?
There are, yeah. We've looked to some other models. And the ones that we've really studied are places like Fort Collins, Colorado, Seattle, Washington. San Francisco, California is probably the one that did it first and is doing it the best. They're at about an 85% diversion rate at the moment for their city. Yeah, they've been working on it now for a long time. But yeah, lots of other places.
Portland, I know that from visiting friends.
That's right.
Because you get so confused. You go to throw something away and there's like five different things out there and you're like, what do I do with the, you know.
But again, that's if right you live there, you get used to it.
Well,
you,
and I think this is why these listening sessions are such a good idea, because if you don't realize what people will resist, then you're not gonna, I mean, everyone's got to buy in.
Mm-hmm.
So finding complaints and people saying, I don't want to do this and here's why, is probably a very large part of coming up with a successful plan.
Absolutely.
To conserve the waste.
This is a topic that almost everyone, it's so tangible for them.
Yeah.
And as they travel, they recognize those differences and they form an opinion and they have ideas. And I think we're going to just find and hear a whole bunch of really interesting information in these listening sessions and throughout this process.
Nice.
Yeah.
So go tell Chase what you think.
Yeah.
Please.
Go to 0by50.com.
The 2nd, the 7th, the 8th.
Right, which is the Brook Street, the Burn Street, or the front
the
street, the library.
And get your thoughts out there. Help this whole process out.
You want them to come right at 6? Is this kind of drop-in-ish, or is it more of a program like 6 to 8, come at 6?
Yeah, so we'll have an informational kind of presentation right at the beginning, right at 6. And so, I think
it's more like come at 6. Don't just wander in at 7:30 and start complaining about recycling.
That's right. But listening session isn't just a clever name. That presentation will be very short.
Okay.
And so we then want to break people into small groups where they're comfortable addressing these questions and sharing their ideas, mm-hmm. and that we can listen a little better too. We're hoping lots of people come out, and so small groups are very effective in that regard.
Yeah.
So we'll do that for the rest of the time, and then we'll come back and the groups will kind of tell us what they dialogued about and their ideas, and we'll sum it up by 8.
Excellent.
That's great. I can't wait to hear what comes out of this.
Chase, thanks so much for coming by.
Thank you.
I guess we better go. Jeepers, we're running out of time, I guess. My Fitbit's broken, so I don't know.
You keep tapping your
Yeah, well, you see it.
501.
501, we gotta go, people. Thank you so much for watching this edition of Missoula Live for MCAT. I'm Joel Baird.
And I'm Kim Anderson.
We'll see you next time, March 6th.